Hi, Bestie. Welcome back to Girl House with Callie.
And Celia.
We were just chatting. We feel like our intro is a little like
really
dorky, but we don't know how to change it because we obviously need to tell you who this
is. This even making sense? It just feels weird.
It just feels so like every time where it's like, welcome back to Girl House with Callie and
Celia.
It just feels like so much.
Yeah. But welcome back.
Welcome back. I feel like I haven't chatted with you in so long because we recorded so early last week, I think, again. So much has happened since we last talked to you. Like, I can't even... It's crazy. Like, I don't even know where to start. And some things we can't share yet. But I guess I'll start with my update, my birthday update. This is why you don't have expectations for your birthday,
yeah.
And this is why I never
do.
This is
a good example of that.
I had, honestly, such a shitty birthday, like literally, like holy hell. So, I booked us a hotel in Carmel. I was so excited about it, And we bring Ducky and Celia's dog Vita. And Celia's dog Vita was recently in heat, and Ducky's balls just dropped. So he was just like losing his mind over her, and she was like growling at him, trying to protect herself because she didn't want to be humped, and she like could tell he wanted to hump.
It was a whole
and
situation.
He like barked the entire 5-hour drive up, and then we also, this pissed me the hell off. So I will never get over this. We stopped at In-N-Out. We're so excited because we're so hungry. We stopped to go eat In-N-Out, and Ducky was like, he wasn't even barking, and trust me, I find him so annoying when he barks. It drives me crazy. Like, it drives me more crazy than anyone around me. But he was just doing a little like whiny whine, like it was nothing, and like everyone was like saying how cute him and Vita were, and like one of the employees came up to us and like said how cute they were. And keep in mind, it was this specific employee that is important later. So then this man comes up to us in the most condescending way, and he's like with his wife and their new, I don't know how old the baby was, but he comes up to us in like the most condescending way, and he says, hey, maybe one of you should go and take both dogs outside because we have a sleeping baby. And
no, even more condescending.
Yeah,
it was like, maybe one of you should order and one of you should go outside with the dogs because it's really loud.
Yeah. And we have a sleeping baby.
Yeah.
And
mind you, literally whining. Like, it would be one thing if it was like nonstop. It wasn't even barking.
Also, I would have less of a problem if he just came up and was like, hey, can one of you guys go outside with the dogs because they're barking? Fine. He also got the In-N-Out employee. Like, I could tell she felt awkward, but she like told us to bring the dogs. We ended up leaving. The issue I have that's so insane is that you have a problem with noise in a fast food restaurant that you brought your sleeping
where
baby
they
to
yell out the like the numbers when the orders are ready and yell out all this
I'm,
random stuff.
We were so mad at, like, it just still
no,
makes
this
me
just made me fuming. I don't even know why.
I'm sorry, but if you have a sleeping baby and you're concerned about noise, don't bring the baby to a fast food restaurant, or bring, you know what, go through the drive-through.
Yeah.
Like, I'm all for, like, I am very empathetic towards when, like, babies are crying, and, like, obviously, like, I don't want to go around upsetting babies, but, like...
It was shocking.
It was
That's
in
the
a,
only way to put it. And the way that, like, he just came over and clearly, like, felt so awesome.
It would be, like another thing if we were even in, like, a quiet restaurant, and,
yeah,
like, they... But, like...
Also, we're very good at, like, reading the room. We're not a-holes. Like,
just,
this
like,
is not, like, some outrageous...
I'll just never get over it. If, like, that's honestly your problem that you have a sleeping baby. Like,
yeah.
I...
And he just, like, I could just tell he felt, like, so high and mighty. Like,
yeah.
I'm sure he was, like, making a joke when we left to everyone else around us. Like, good for him. Anyway.
Anyway, that was, like... That just pissed us off.
A little female rage.
Yeah.
To get that out.
But... We got to Carmel. We went out to dinner to my favorite restaurant in Carmel, the Treehouse Cafe. Mm-hmm. And it's funny because last year, Viv and I, we like really made a whole scene at the Treehouse Cafe because we were going every night and drinking like fish. And we befriended every single person at the restaurant who worked there. So then we would like stay after the restaurant closed, get really drunk on their like little... deck they have, and then we would go out with the employees. But the problem is, like, I just felt like it got, like, a little weird, and I kind of blocked them all. Like, only because, like, I was just, like, that was said and done, and they were, like, trying to message more. And they're all, like, very sweet guys. I just felt, I feel bad about blocking them now. My one big, like, one thing I can't handle on my birthday, which I talked about to you in the episode before, is people knowing it's my birthday. It makes me so uncomfortable. I beg Celia, please don't say anything. Before we get into the restaurant, I'm like, okay, can we just, like, not mention it's my birthday? 2 seconds later, the second we sit down, she has something to tell you. It's her birthday. And then
I came over and they were chatting and I was just a bit tipsy.
And then they brought us wine and cake, which that was very sweet, but it made me so uncomfortable, especially because I, like, blocked the whole restaurant. And now they're bringing me cheesecake and champagne. It was very sweet. And I feel terrible because we were going to go see them, like, the next night and go out with them, but...
We were going to go out with them?
Probably.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah. I mean, they're just, like, a fun crew to hang with.
It's just funny because you blocked them all.
Yeah, but it wasn't personal.
Yeah.
It was more safety. Just, like, not even safety. It was just kind of, like... It was a Carmel thing, and I didn't want it being, like, it seemed like the conversation wanted to continue, but I just wanted to keep it in Carmel. Like, it's, like, my magical Carmel little weird thing I do. I
have to rendezvous with them soon.
But anyway, yeah, we got back to the hotel room, and it was just, like, a nightmare, and so we got in the car and drove home at 10 p.m. and got back at 3 because it just, like, wasn't doable. Like, the dogs would not. It was impossible. So that was my birthday. But, I mean, it's definitely a very memorable birthday for a lot of reasons. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, we watched the sunset at the beach, and then we went home. But I guess that's, like, do I have any other updates on my end? Is anything?
I mean, this is a jam-packed week for me.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. What are your updates?
I mean... Well, I think this is one of the questions coming up, right?
Yeah.
But I will say, September is back, fall is in the air, and there are many shows. One, Tell Me Lies came out today. Two, so by the time you're listening, all of these will be out. And then tomorrow, The Perfect Couple comes out on Netflix, which is the Ellen Hildebrand series. And then also tomorrow, First Chiefs game. Which I'm so excited because, yes, Taylor will most likely be in attendance. And I really, like, I know you think it's so weird, but last year when I was so depressed, the Chiefs games were something to look forward to. And I've talked about this before. I made myself buffalo chicken dip. The best time ever. Like, I just loved it. I don't know.
I don't think it's weird. I think it's more, like, the idea of you sitting in your room.
Yeah.
Like, cheering at the TV is just hilarious to me, and I could never imagine it. Like, it's just
to see it.
It's a side of you I don't know at all.
Yeah, it was kind of just what one might call me time. And I'm a little stressed because I have used so many different emails to create a free Fubo account, and I'm a little stressed about if this game.
Yeah, but I'm sure, like you said, you could watch it on TikTok.
Well, live.
Or you could go to a sports bar.
Okay, you know what? This is the one thing I really enjoy.
No, I'm being completely serious. They'll have it on the sports bar.
This is true. Well, this is the big dilemma, is that it's Kansas City versus Baltimore. But all I'm saying is, like, no, I'm serious. The big dilemma is that it doesn't come on West Coast sometimes. Yeah. Like, imagine how pissed I am if I use an email to get my free trial and then it's not even showing because I'm in the LA area and it only shows, like, the LA game.
Yeah,
like Western, whatever. So we'll see how it goes, but yeah, I can't wait to see all that back in action. And that's just, like, even though it was, like, a depressing time, it was such, like, a nice, that's why I was looking forward to fall for so long. So yeah, that all starts this week, and I feel like something else is happening like this week. Something else September comes out, but I can't remember.
I have no idea.
We're also watching The Watcher right now, a little late to the game.
Yeah, we are watching. Good. I started it with a man that I was hooking up with, and then he said we were just best friends. That whole situation I've told you about several times, a situationship that destroyed me. And so I never finished it, but now I was feeling ready to watch it.
It's very good.
It's really good, but I guess that's like, I don't think I have anything else on my end update wise.
La Cabaña in 2 weeks.
Yeah, La Cabaña in 2 weeks. If you haven't gotten your tickets yet, there's a few left. Remember to get them because we want to see you all there. It's linked in this episode if you look on the info, and we'll also link it in the Girl House bio on Instagram. So if you don't follow Girl House Pod, go follow it, and it's linked there. And if you go for the information for this episode, linked there as well. Tonight we're gonna do a Q&A because we just, I don't know, a little like we, I feel like we haven't just checked in with you. We're just gonna try to bang out like
as many as possible
and just like go straight through finish. I'm not even gonna read them. I'm just gonna, well, I'm gonna read them out loud. Like, I'm gonna have to read your mind. Usually we pre-read them. Yeah. Okay. Let's How do you start. Always slay so hard? Thank you, Bestie. Me personally, I don't know. I felt like I haven't been slaying, but you know, it's a glow from within, I guess. I don't know. How do you slay so hard?
Believe in yourself.
Yes, I'm true.
Know who you are. It's hard some days, but just try to find
it till you make it.
So true.
Confidence is key.
Yeah. Confidence is a mindset. That's the one thing I will say.
What are your goals for the future? I mean, this is, I could... Ah, gosh, what a week to ask this.
Yeah.
My goals for the future are to be happy.
I was just going to say to be happy and leave it at that.
Yeah.
Because I have so many things as well, but we're going through a lot of things.
Yeah.
Changes.
Trying to figure it all out. A lot of big changes, yeah. I just want to be happy and feel, like, secure in my life and feel like I think... If I was a rapper, I would write a song called Los Angeles.
Please.
Because I just feel so lost here.
Yeah.
And it breaks my heart that I feel lost here because I love it here so much. But I just realized, like, I feel lost.
Big
less lost
things.
Than big. We've been realizing a lot of things lately.
I hope for both of us that we just find true happiness.
Yeah, me too.
Because, like, it's also just been hitting, like, oh my gosh, with you turning 27, like, it's scary getting older, but, like, life is really only what you make it.
What are both of y'all's favorite comfort shows to rewatch? XO, love you, besties.
OC.
Yours is definitely the OC. I've only watched that once. Mine are, I love, if you haven't watched the show Felicity, it's so comforting. Sabrina the Teenage Witch is a huge comfort show for me. When I need comfort, I go to that. Gilmore Girls, obviously. Ghost Whisperer, huge comfort show.
Never seen the Ghost Whisperer.
It's so good. My mom and I used to watch it all the time.
Schitt's Creek for me, if I need like a laugh.
Yeah. House is a comfort show for me. And what other comfort shows do I have?
Love Island, my gosh.
Desperate Housewives. Housewives got me through like one of the hardest breakups of my life. That is like my ultimate comfort show. Not to be confused with like the Housewives of. Like,
yeah.
Because whenever I say to my dad that I love the show Desperate Housewives, he always thinks I'm talking about the reality show. And I'm like, it's not the reality show. It's a beautifully, and I'm not saying anything bad about the reality show, but it is a beautifully made drama. Like... one of the best. That's my like all-time top one.
The OC is so comforting to me because I like watched it with my mom.
Yeah.
And at like a certain time in life. But yeah, like I said, Schitt's Creek for hilarious, OC to just get lost in. Obviously, I could say Gossip Girl too, but the OC is like more comforting.
Yeah, and Gossip Girl's hard to watch on platforms now because they removed it, didn't
really?
They? Yeah, they removed it from Netflix like 2 years
it's
ago.
It's gonna be on something. I don't know. Big Little Lies, duh.
Oh, Big Little Lies, great comfort watch.
Yeah.
I love any show where someone's life is going to shit for comfort because it makes me feel like so much better about my own life. I'm like, things could... That's why I watch so many, like whenever I'm anxious, I will watch Interrogations.
Yeah, you'd love those.
It just makes me feel so much better.
Oh, this isn't my comfort show. Granted, I haven't even watched like any of it, but it could be. Grey's Anatomy. Like it was so... I guess any show I'm watching with my mom. Like... Yeah. Law and Order, SVU, like all those vibes.
I've always
when you're
wanted
watching
to
it.
Get into Law and Order, but
you
just,
haven't.
No.
Okay, you should. Like Criminal Minds, like anything that I watch with my mom, then becomes like comfort, I guess.
Yeah.
Anyway,
love that.
Yeah, you would love Law and Order.
I've tried to get into it a few times and I just haven't. But I have trouble getting into TV shows.
Yeah.
How do you cope with being alone in relationships or just daily life? Well, relationship wise, we are like really about to hit the 5-year mark of being single for me, which is crazy because if you told my 22-year-old self that, oh yeah, after this breakup, you're going to be single for 5 years, I don't even know what I would have done. Anyway, I think I've just like really learned, I was actually talking about this with my friend Viv on the phone the other day, like at the end of the day, like you don't need a romantic relationship, like obviously I can't wait to have a romantic relationship, but it's so like having friendships and like especially like girlhood is just so,
you know,
special, like just surrounding yourself with people who like really care about you and love you, whether that's family or friends or pets, like surrounding yourself with like positivity. It just like there's other ways to fill
your cup.
Sure. Yeah.
I was literally going to say it when I like spoke on this, no like way. Fill your cup with other things.
I didn't know where to go after I said fill. So I'm glad you filled me in. But yeah, there's just other ways to fill your cup than a romantic relationship. And I feel like it's like a hard thing because obviously like there's also things you can get from a romantic relationship that you can't get from friends, but it's going to come. Like I really believe if you want it, it will come. So just like try to stay calm and like enjoy your life. And I mean, I think being alone more in general, like in daily life, I say this all the time and I probably sound like a broken record, but I think being alone is so important in your life. And mm-hmm. I had the biggest transformation in 2021. I was like living at my parents' house and in law school during the pandemic, and my mom is immunocompromised, so I couldn't even see her. At this point, she was living, my grandpa like owned a house like in a different town, so she was like 20 minutes away in a house like by herself, which I can't imagine that would have sucked too. And later she like lived in our house but like plexiglass. I basically couldn't see my mom for like a year, and my dad was at work all day, and I was basically like alone all day, and I couldn't see any friends, especially when my mom moved in, because I didn't want to bring like any germs into the house. So anyway, I spent that year not seeing any friends, not hanging out with anyone. Like it was, I've never been that alone. And at first it was like really daunting and like, what the hell? And I like don't, and I was also going through a breakup, the breakup of 2019, my last relationship. But I remember hitting a point where like, I was like, I can't just like be upset about this and be depressed about this. This is the situation right now. And it forced me, this was the most special thing I've ever learned. It forced me to learn how to be best friends with myself. And I would like, I started by just going for walks with myself every morning and like being intentional, being like, okay, I'm like walking with myself. This is someone I'm with. Like I am someone and I'm hanging out with someone, which sounds like crazy, but like if you think that way, like I would go on drives, like I would drive like 40 minutes to a Barnes and Noble, like a far away, and listen to an audiobook, and then like spend time in Barnes and Noble, then like treat myself to a little like snack on the way home, and just be so intentional about hanging out with myself and enjoying it. And my whole point being like that time being alone was so important because it forced me to grow so much. And I think in life, you go through so many periods of being lonely, and every single time I've been lonely is the most growth I've ever had. I think it's so important because you get to know yourself. You get to like really think about what you want. I started my TikTok career out of pure loneliness, like, and it changed my life. So I think being lonely can be a positive thing if you twist your thinking, because it's such an opportunity to grow. So that's my whole take on being lonely. I think being lonely in points in your life is, first of all, just like unavoidable, and second of all, like very important. And it's better to be lonely than surrounded by people who aren't good for you. Like, seriously.
That was so beautifully said.
Thank you. Just talked about it a lot.
Yeah. No, we can move on to the next. I feel like you really summed that right up.
You have nothing to say? Yeah.
I agree with everything you said.
You have the fill the cup part. Being alone. Yeah, you do enjoy being
and
alone.
And I think, like, yeah, again, with romantic relationships, obviously that's tricky if you're like longing for it. But again, you can't just like sitting around and like wishing for it won't bring it. You have to fill your cup with other things, and then you'll be ready for it.
Do the messy women ever sprint around in the middle of the night? Because mine do. They did when they were kittens. Before, when they were like younger, I feel like they didn't have the same sleeping schedule as me, so they would sprint around at all hours. But they're pretty, like, Luna is staring at me in such a creepy way right
now. In New York, I feel like Cleo used to a lot, like, when I'd sleep over.
Oh, yeah, maybe. You're also, maybe they do run around, and I don't know, because I'm, like, a pretty heavy sleeper. So, oh, yeah, I guess Cleo.
I feel like Cleo had a mellowed out.
Yeah, no, Cleo had a crazy era in New York. That's actually so true. But, no, they're very chill here. They go to bed when I go to bed, and they wake up when I wake up, so. But they have their moments. How did you know it was the right time to move to LA? You can answer this one first if you want. You came here before me.
Yeah, I knew that I wanted to be in styling, and I was in a relationship in New York in which this man had a house in California, and we spent a lot of time here, like during lockdown. And so, not during lockdown, but during like the COVID time. And then I think just spending that time here, like, I realized how beautiful it was and how, like, much I loved it here and, like, wanted to be here. And I also, like, happened to get out of the relationship, so then I wanted something to, like, really work towards, and I really wanted to get into celebrity styling, which felt like LA was the place. So I saved and saved and saved and then moved here.
Yeah, you kind of just, like, set a date. You were like, I'm moving in October, and you did.
Yeah, I was so determined, and as I mentioned with you, I think a lot of it was, like, a lot of stuff kept happening in my life, and I just wanted something to set a goal towards, and then I did.
Yeah, and you did it fast as hell. I mean, you really, when you set your mind to something, it happens.
Yeah, that was, like, the most manifested thing I'd ever, like,
yeah,
because after my dad passing, and then I was in this relationship, and then I wanted to end the relationship, and I just felt like, okay, I need something to, like, really work towards to distract myself, I think. And so I set a goal of the stylist that I wanted to work for and just everything. And then I came here and I made it happen, and I'm no longer doing that. But I just feel like it was such an important moment for me, my career, everything, to just realize, like, I can do what I want to do.
Yeah.
And you can move across the country, and it will be a part of your journey.
Yeah, so true.
Also, in fairness, my sister was here, which made things a lot easier for me.
Yeah.
But
I decided it was the right time to move to LA. I was always so against LA because all my family's from, like, the Bay Area. So growing up, I always heard how much LA sucked, because if you're from the Bay Area, or really, like, anywhere else in the country, but, like, especially the Bay Area, like, you hear how much LA sucks. So I was like, I will never move to LA ever, 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 ever. But then I was so lost in New York, hated my life, was like, what the hell? And you were here, and
you visited so much when I first moved.
Oh my gosh, I visited so much. So I, one day I was just like, you know what? Like, it's either renew my lease in New York or try to make a change. So I just, like, honestly randomly moved here in March. Yeah.
Sorry, Elf. I want to say something after.
But yeah, it was, like, honestly, it was very random, but I don't regret anything because I think it's all led me to right where I am now.
Well, that's what I was going to say, like, in terms of, like, making a change, like, sometimes you just do stuff, and, like, I'm not saying moving to LA is a light thing in the slightest, but, like, it's all a part of our journey.
Yeah.
And, like, sometimes you just need to do something to make a change, even if it's not, like, long-term forever. Yeah. It's, like, if I hadn't done this, I don't know where I would be.
Yeah.
Sometimes I feel like it's so crazy that I did this, but at the same time, if I had never done this, like...
No, I know. I mean, it forces... Every single chapter of your life forces you to grow.
So. Yeah, so much so.
Tips for college. I am starting apps right now. I'm freaking the fuck out, bestie. Tips for college, like applying to college. I don't even remember applying to college. I know that sounds like I remember applying to law school, but I don't remember applying. I don't remember applying to college because I didn't care about college. I was in my party girl phase, barely passed the SAT or whatever scored. I don't know. I got into, like, two colleges, so it wasn't really much for me, but you cared more.
I, like, toured a bunch of schools, I remember, prior to applying, and then I applied to Syracuse Early Decision. Like, I was so set on it, and I got in, and I remember being so happy, but then there was no way I could afford it, and that was really a slap in the damn face. So then I ended up going elsewhere, but I just, like, that's the part that I really vividly remember in the library, because I got my acceptance and everyone was, like, so excited, but then I was like, I can't go here. So, because they didn't give me, like, literally a dime. Like, that's not crazy. A single thing. But I remember, like, the actual, what was the question about actually applying?
Well, do you have any application tips? I just don't remember what you even have to do in the application.
I think it's, isn't it, like, one common app?
I have no idea.
I'm pretty sure. And then you answer, like, questions specific for each school. Yeah, that's a tricky one. I know, like, writing the college essay.
Yeah.
It's crazy.
My personal statement, I mean, I can give advice on that, which is, like, a little different. But for law school, you have to write a personal statement. And I was always told, like, just, like, don't make it cliche. Like, don't write about, like, your, like, volunteer trip to, like, wherever you went. Like, they don't. Law schools don't want to hear that. I think colleges might want to hear it a little more. I don't know. But, like, I think it's better to not be cliche. I wrote my, if you need, like, any, like, brainstorming, if this, like, applies to your life, I wrote my law school personal statement on how much I hate change and, like, dealing with the, like, adversities you face in life that, like, bring change. So, but that was law school.
I think for my college essay, not that it's the same, but
I do remember writing a college essay now.
Yeah.
I don't know what it was about. Yours? No, I don't remember what it was.
Mine, I just remember the advice that I was given was to make it a way to explain who you are through something else.
Yeah.
I don't know if that's great advice, but mine was about losing my cousin. He had passed away.
Oh, I remember you reading your essay to us.
To you?
You read it to me and Zadie.
Oh. Yeah, I probably did. No, I probably did. But it was about my cousin who had passed away while I was in high school. He was, like, an older cousin and he had cancer. But it was, like, showed who that made me and, like, how it affected me. But, like, in a positive way as well.
Yeah.
And, like, everything I learned from him. It was, like, that was the way that I had written it. But I remember someone specifically telling me to write about an experience or a story or something that shows who you are without, like, telling this is who I am.
I think that's great
and, like,
advice.
How I handled situation that's, and what I learned and those sorts of things.
I think that's great
because it shows
advice.
How you can handle
like
what adversity it was thrown at you, I guess. I don't know.
Law school, I guess they kind of said the same thing. The advice I got for that was to write, like, think about yourself like you have all, like, the numbers and the scores. Okay, they're going to see your grades and your scores, but what makes you different from, like, those other people? Like, what trait do you have aside from your grades and SAT scores that will make you, like, a better candidate for them to choose you? So I guess it kind of...
And even for undergrad, too, it's, like, this is the only place,
like,
you can write.
That applies to undergrad.
It's the only way you place that you can use words and you're not just a statistic number, how well you scored or whatever.
How to get over being ghosted when you think the date went well. I'm devastated. We were just talking about this. I think, like, we've all been there.
Ghosting is just so immature at this point.
So unbelievably immature. I don't ghost. I went on a date the other night with a guy and he thought the date went well and I didn't. Now I, like, feel like I have a soft spot for him because he sent me, like, a really sweet birthday text, but I didn't feel like the date went well. So I just told him, like he asked for a second date and I was like, it's not going to happen right now, buddy. Like, in a really nice way, but, like...
Imagine that's what you'd say.
Yeah. But, like, ghosting is just so rude and so immature. It's a reflection of, like, where they stand. It has nothing to do with you. Or maybe it does have something to do with you. I'm not going to say it has nothing to do with you because, as we said in the last episode, you're not going to be everyone's cup of tea. But I think the way you have to think about ghosting, and I was, like, upset about being ghosted, like, a little earlier in the year... And the way you have to think about it is just like, okay, the universe is weeding this person
not
out.
Your
that
person,
made it so easy. Like, thank God they're not stringing me along. Like, would it have been nicer for them to send a text? Sure. But, like, that just shows how immature and how much they suck
or
are.
If they can't even send the text, like, yeah,
you just don't want them in your life. And like, no. I know it feels like such a rejection. It feels so sad, but like, I try to switch my thinking, and obviously easier said than done, but like, think like, oh my gosh, this is so exciting because I'm one person closer to meeting my person. This wasn't the person. Like, you don't want to be with someone who's not your person, and your person like doesn't not like you. Like, that would really, and like, not everyone's gonna like you. And I've learned, like, it's so hard to wrap your head around.
You love that line.
No, I know, because it's so hard to wrap your head around the fact that you can have such a deep connection with someone and like them so much, and they can feel nothing for you. Like,
I know,
deep connections and like deep feelings can be one-sided, and that blows That's my crazy. Mind because for so long I've been like, oh, like, there's no way, like, if I like them, of course they like me. But that's just not
always the case.
Like, sometimes it's a one-sided connection. So I'm sorry you're going through that, but
yeah, same.
Do you have any advice on that?
Oh, same thing. I just think ghosting is like so immature at this point.
Yeah.
And if they're ghosting you, like, you don't want to be with someone like that.
How did you decide on going to law school? I have a whole episode on this if you want to listen. It was like one of my, like, I think it was like my second or third episode if you want to listen to the whole thing. But I, like, long story very short, I was insanely lost in life. I had just come off a complete mental breakdown from my first year at college, where I almost failed out of college, almost went to rehab, which rehab's not a bad thing, but I was almost in rehab. I did have to go to drug counseling. It was like this whole thing. I was like really not okay. I was put on antidepressants. Anyway, I transferred schools to Suffolk with Celia in Boston, and I had to declare my major. I had read a Jodi Picoult book when I was in third grade about a struggling lawyer, and it like really stuck in my brain. And I like was like, I want to be a lawyer. I don't know why, because this lawyer was like struggling like crazy. But then I like said something to a friend. I was like, I want to be a lawyer. They were like, don't do it. My dad hates his life. So like, I put that out of my head. Then fast forward. Okay, now we're at Suffolk. I have to declare a major. I decide to do pre-med for God knows why. Other than like, I still like, sometimes I'm like, oh, should I go to med school? Like, I still like would love to be in the medical profession. I think that's like so awesome and like my dream profession, but I'm so bad at science and so bad at math. It just would have been so hard. So I went to my first chem class, and I remember my dad warned me like before I started my pre-med classes, like, they're gonna try to weed people out. And I was like, yeah, all good. I go to my first pre-med class, and it was chem, and they were like, if you don't know this, this, or this, you should leave. And I literally, my eyes started tearing up, because like, this was like such like a not turn of the page moment. Is that a turn of the turning the leaf? I don't know, like, whatever that saying. It was like a huge, like, transferring to Suffolk, it was like starting my life over. Like, I wasn't doing drugs anymore or like being reckless, and like, I wanted to get good grades again. Like, I finally cared about my life for the first time in years. So I was like, I don't want to fuck this up. So I like think that's why I started crying, because I was like, oh my god, I'm going to fuck this up. I was like, maybe I'll be an English major, because like, reading's always been my strength. And then she was like, well, we have a great pre-law program, why don't you try it? And then like, my brain like all of a sudden like zooms back to third grade, like me wanting to be a lawyer, struggling lawyer, Jodi Picoult. And I was like, hell yeah. And then kind of like same thing you said with coming to LA for styling, like, I just finally had a goal to like stick to. Law school just like changed my life for the better, and being a pre-law student, like, it just gave me something to work towards and like not gear off track. So yeah, I got to like deciding to go to law school, and like a really kind of, it was just like random, to be honest. Like, I don't have any family members who are lawyers, or like really, like, I never planned on being a lawyer except for reading that Jodi Picoult book that really stuck with me. But
also, might I add, Suffolk was very well known for their law school and pre-law program.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, like, that was a great opportunity.
Oh, yeah. But what I was going to say is, it just, like, really helped me. Like, I was so, like, struggling so much and, like, just going down so many dark paths. Like, finding something I could grasp onto and, like, really work towards and have, like, this insane, like, goal like that, like, I think saved my literal life. So I really thank Suffolk for their pre-law program, and I do plan to donate to Suffolk one day.
Yeah,
and Brooklyn,
say that,
because I really mean it. I like, no, they, like, yeah, literally, like, actually, like, Brooklyn of course I'll donate to, But like Suffolk is getting more money because they like actually saved my life. So
yeah.
Both girlies, share one moment that comes to mind that defined your 20s.
That's so hard. I feel like my 20s have been so many different eras. Yeah. And same with you. Like, I can't even remember when I was 20 in comparison. Like,
I know.
21. Like, when we had to, like, not have our IDs. That's crazy.
And defining my 20s. You know what probably, like, I guess defined my 20s, like, a moment was dating my ex in undergrad. The one who put me through so much, who he was struggling a lot mentally, but like he was also just not a nice person. Anyway, his family lived in New York and I'd always go with him to the city to visit his family. And that, like, visiting New York made me realize I wanted to move to New York. And so that gave me like another goal to work towards, was getting into law school in New York. Because I wanted to live there, not even because of him, because I just like loved it so much. So I guess dating him was a pretty defining moment in my 20s, because I wouldn't have gone to New York if it wasn't for him. Then I wouldn't have been the New York law student TikToker. Maybe my TikTok wouldn't have gone where it was. Like, yeah, I guess that's
it,
like,
could have, just not in that way. Yeah.
Well, yeah, I know. I'm just saying, like, that was my defining moment. So. Yeah. That I can, like, really think of, like, yeah.
Yeah, obviously, I just realized what mine was, and it's kind of depressing.
Yeah.
My heart kind of just sunk, but I would, it has to be my dad.
Yeah.
Kind of ruined my 20s.
Yeah.
Not ruined, but definitely defined.
Yeah.
I'm not trying to be all, blech,
no,
but yeah.
It's all good.
Definitely was crazy the year I turned 23. And yeah. That also COVID, I would say, is a huge part of both of our 20s.
Yeah, that's true.
And then I guess, yeah, the moment that I decided I'm moving to LA, that was a pretty defining part of my 20s as well.
Yeah, there's so many defining moments.
Yeah, again, they're all just different eras, like, yeah. Completely. Like, I had a college life, a New York life, a grief life,
yeah,
an LA life, and here we are.
Yeah.
And, like, all of them were so different. And, like, no, I literally feel like I've lived so many different. And, like, each part,
yeah,
brought
we have
so
lived,
much.
You do so much in your 20s. What the
yeah,
hell?
I mean, it's 10 years. Think about from the time you were 10 to 20.
Well, we're 27.
I know. Okay, fine. 10 to 17. That's a huge amount of time.
Yeah. Would you ever move away from LA? What an interesting question, bestie. I don't know. There's a lot going on right now that we cannot quite talk to you about yet. It's all positive things, but some, like, very big
exciting
changes going on, and that's, like, as much as I will say.
I will say that I've always, I won't say always, but I've felt like I was gonna move home.
Yeah.
For a while. I just don't know exactly when that's going to be.
I don't know when I'm going to end back up on the East Coast, but I do know that with life and things going on, it might make sense to end up there sooner than later. There's not, like, a
yeah,
set plan.
That's exactly how I feel.
And, like, the idea of leaving Venice, like, actually, like, I get emotional talking about it. It breaks my heart, but sometimes, like, I don't know. It's all positive things. It's just, we'll get into it more on another episode, but all
it's
positive.
It's also just weird, like, growing up, our family being there, it's all so, like, strange.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, if I could just get my parents out here, I would not go back, but I can't, so. I'm struggling, bestie. How do I stop caring about what others think of me? You just have to, at the end of the day, it doesn't matter. Like, it's not going to, I've gotten to that point, especially, like, with being on social media and everyone thinking I'm, like,
yeah, you're better
an
at this
idiot
than me.
Like, well, I wasn't. It just, I got forced into it because I would lose my mind. And of course, like, that's not to say, like, I don't still care what people say about me, but there are, like, literal, like, people will make up the most insane stuff about me. Whether, like, it's just, like, someone's opinion of you, like, not everyone's going to like you, as I love to say, and it's just, it really only matters, like, your, like, the true people who you want in your life and who should be in your life are not going to judge you or make you feel embarrassed about anything you're doing or weird about anything you're doing. And yeah. I've just learned, like, aside from them, who cares what other people think? Obviously easier said than done, but like, it just doesn't matter. It's not like it's not going to actually affect you. And everyone is so self-absorbed. Like, no one's really thinking about you that deeply. Like, it's just like,
you and just if they are, then they care so much about you, you know?
Yeah. So like, you just have to try to let it go, because caring what other people think is just, I mean, last time I cared what someone thought about me was when I was devastated by my situationship and I almost ruined my entire career because I refused to post online because I like thought he would think I was being, he like thought TikTok was a foolish career. So I just like stopped posting.
Yeah.
To try to act like I didn't care, because he didn't care. And that like almost destroyed my career. So when you started TikTok, did you ever picture yourself being where you are now? Definitely not. My dad and I like still joke about this because he, oh, like I like would joke and be like, I'm going to make money on TikTok one day. But I like, he would always be like, I'll be like impressed if I see $100, like he would be like blown away. And when I first started posting on TikTok, it was humiliating. First of all, second of all, it was weird as hell thirst traps. I don't like to talk about it. I don't know how to explain it, but it happened. And so, like, I didn't even know where, like, my TikTok was really going.
What were your first, like, talking videos? Because I know you did vlogs after the thirst traps.
But my first, talking videos, I remember I'd get so shaky talking because I, like, it's so funny. Like, I was not used to talking to the camera. So when I would, I'd have to refilm so many times because I was shaking so bad. Like, I'd get so shy and nervous. But my first videos are me, like, answering law school questions. And like, if you go back, sometimes people will like still like them. And if you go back and watch like my first talking videos, like I don't even sound like myself because I was just like so nervous to be talking.
Did people ask the questions or you just?
Yeah, people asked questions and then I answered them.
Got it.
But did I think I would be where I am now? Like, definitely not. I am so insanely grateful to have like so many sweet besties and so much support. Like, I will, oh, it's just like, it's crazy. And I would never have expected this, but I wouldn't change it for the world. I'm like, every day I wake up just so grateful that like, this is my job. It's insane. When I started TikTok, I was like, this is why I always tell people, like, start TikTok, post the embarrassment, like just do it. Because I posted through the embarrassment. When I started posting on TikTok, I posted 3 times a day, every day for a year. And that was like in the midst of like law school, like did not have time to be posting, but I'd force myself, I'd make time. And it, like, I just like took it seriously for a year to see what would happen, and it like worked out. So, and it takes a while to like find your niche and like find people who are like, at first the only people who followed me were like creepy 50-year-old men, but like slowly I found my niche. It like takes a while. You kind of have to post through it, and then like the followers who like are supposed to be with you will come find you. But yeah, no, I never thought I would be where I was now. It's crazy. Like, so I can't even, it's crazy. Should I get back with my ex? I would argue, usually, like, I don't know the circumstance, but no, it never goes, yeah. It's never gone well for me.
Yeah. Next question.
Favorite restaurant on the West Side for takeout? I've never gotten takeout here, but I've tried to, but their takeout was closed for so long and it's finally open again. But Jelena, I would get their 4 onion pizza for takeout. Or I also love Giada for takeout. I'll order that all the time. Those are my 2 favorite takeout places.
Yeah, I feel like they dominate Venice.
Yeah. And
Giada, Jelena, Giusta.
Unpopular opinion, but Pizza Hut. I love.
Yeah, what do you mean you get takeout all the time if you include Pizza Hut?
Yeah, I love. I'm such a Pizza Hut girl. I love it so much. It's like, yeah, honestly, my favorite pizza.
Basically, the only places I'd say we go out consistently, La Cabaña, Jelena, am I missing?
Yeah, no, that's it.
Yeah.
Oh, you know where I order from for breakfast sometimes is Egg Slut. I love Egg Slut.
Yeah, you do.
Favorite things to do alone besides hot girl walks? I love to Mod Podge. If you don't know, I will go and buy like vintage Playboy magazines. Mod Podge is like this like water-based glue and canvas, and I will make like pieces. I will just like, and it's so nice because it gets your hands off your phone because your hands are so sticky, you can't like touch your phone. So
I was gonna say an alternative.
So I'll do that, or when I'm really down bad, I will knit. And I love to read. And I love to read. Like, yeah. The reason I love to read thrillers so much is because it gets me out of my head and gets me into someone else's shitty world. And I can, like whatever issue I'm having, I'm like the book I just read, like, her husband, like, killed someone and another person. It's just like, holy hell. Things could be worse.
Yeah. I was going to say, to Mod Podge, though, but then you were like, oh, because it gets you off your phone. But an alternative that I do is that doesn't require going out and buying, like, all these things would be just making mood boards on Pinterest.
Yeah.
Same sort of. Obviously, it's way more fun to do IRL.
Yeah.
But that's a quicker version.
Yeah. Would you like to be married and have kids one day?
Yes.
Yes. That's, like, my... I cannot wait for the day to have... Like, I have wanted a baby since the day I was born. And I cannot wait for that era of my life. And I cannot wait to be married. All I want is to be married with kids. I feel like that's what I was born for. Like, that's just what I want so bad. So, yeah.
Same.
How to not feel anxiety about going through a transition period? I think you just have to, like... Well, first, there's, like, two ways you can go about it. You can choose to not think about it as a transition period and just instead, like, live in the... It's really all about, like, living in the moment and choose to, like, just enjoy this time in your life. Like, don't think, like, oh, like, I, like, this has to be, like, some, like, temporary. Because I feel like when you get in your head about something being, like, temporary or transition-y, then you... It takes away from, like, just enjoying the moment. Like, I know before I moved from New York to LA, like... I felt like in such a transition mode, like those past, like 2 months, I just like,
yeah,
didn't even do anything or function or enjoy myself because I was just like, I need to get the hell out of New York. But like looking back, like I wish I would have had like more fun and enjoyed the transition period. And so I think you just need to, I mean, like the other, yeah, I think the other way you can think of a transition period, and I had a therapist tell me this once, was like, there's going to be some points in your life where like, you're just not going to be that happy, and that's just okay, and that's life. And once you accept that, life's going to get easier.
Yeah. I feel like I deal with the anxiety of like the in-between a lot whenever I'm going through something like that. And like physically, to go on a walk doesn't help everyone, but like to get up and yeah. move your body and just kind of take time to think rather than let all the stress build up yeah. or like make a little list and check things off. I mean, that's just for anxiety in general.
Yeah.
But anything to kind of just like take it more day by day.
No, your list advice, you told me that in like college, and it's always stuck with me to make a checklist.
I mean, for me, it really does help.
Yeah.
Even if you write advice. Like things that you know you're going to do, like literally brush your teeth, make your bed. Like those are things yeah. that you can do, and then it might help anxiety.
Do you ladies know what you want your future wedding to look like?
Yes.
I am definitely like, the idea of a wedding makes me want to die. I don't know how to explain it other than like, that sounds like so, I wish I wasn't this way, but that sounds like so humiliating to me. I like just couldn't even handle it or fathom it. So I plan to elope, which like also makes me sad because like I do want some sort of wedding, but it just makes me, I'd have to take like 20 Ativan to get married. So that's like not appropriate. So I think I will have like a I'll have a sweet elopement and a little sundress on the beach.
Will I be there and your parents?
Yes.
It just won't be grand.
Yeah, most likely.
Yeah.
I don't know who's going to be there.
Yeah.
It makes me uncomfortable.
Yeah, I know.
And I know you're going to make it like this big thing. So actually, it'll probably just be me and my husband.
Okay.
I don't know. It just makes... I think I'd just like to elope privately.
If that's what makes you feel happiest, it's for you. Yeah. The wedding. I, on the other hand, could talk about this for an entire episode.
Yeah.
But... I guess I'll give mine briefly without giving it all away for when it actually happens. Basically, my husband just has to be on board with this. I do feel very strongly about it, specifically because I told my dad these entire plans.
Yeah.
So it has to happen because I need him to know how I'm getting married. But I plan to have a Nantucket wedding, which my parents had. I want to copy, like I want to get married in the same church as them. But then I want my reception to be in a different location, and something that's so important to me and I don't want to ruin for all the my future wedding guests, but I just think it'd be so cute to come into the welcome party on my dad's boat.
That's
which is currently at my nana's in Mattapoisett, but we could get it over. Yeah. And like me and my husband come in together. Obviously, I know where I want my welcome party, but I won't share that. It's a location on the beach. Everyone dancing. I just want like all the families mingling, dancing, yeah. like absolute best vibes. That will be like, we'll have the rehearsal, then come in for the welcome party where everyone will be there, not even just the rehearsal dinner people. And then the next day will be the wedding.
Yeah.
And it will just be so fabulous. And then probably Sunday we'll have like a, oh, and one thing that I really want, sorry, I could really go on forever, but I don't want to give away the details of my wedding for when it actually happens.
Yeah.
But there's this property at one of my favorite spots in Nantucket that has three houses, and it's like a, you can rent it for like weddings. So I would have like, obviously me and my husband night of, but like all the girls, like the bride's party in one house and then the groom's in the other. And yeah. like we could all get ready together. Like you can so be there fun. With the champagne in the morning. Like it will just be so fun. And like that would be such like a place for everyone to gather. And like we can have bagels there, like breakfast outside. Yeah. Just like everyone oh, will be wait. Hanging around be there. And it's blast. Right on the beach. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I'll be having course. A blast at your wedding.
Yeah. I just I'll cannot wait. I'll
have a
blast wait.
At mine too, but it just won't be a wedding.
And yeah,
I actually recently saw my neighbor just got eloped and I was so surprised about it, but I really? Actually I almost commented like
congrats,
what a nice elopement. Just because like they just hired a photographer and like just like eloped.
No, that's and I was like sweet.
That's just so
yeah. Meanwhile I'm like I know exactly what dress I'll be wearing no. to each of
I like I wish I wasn't weird about things like this. I just am. It makes me uncomfortable. I don't know where it comes from. Like I like, obviously, I feel like a part of me will be, like, missing for not having a wedding, but I know it makes me too uncomfortable, and I would just be miserable.
Yeah.
Like, I just can't handle, like...
It's not enjoyable if you're miserable.
Well, yeah, no shit. That's why I'm not doing it.
Yeah.
But...
I also really want to wear my mom's dress at some point. Aww. I haven't decided which event, but it's, like, one part of the wedding. I think that would be really sweet.
Confession time. Okay. Oh, by the way, send in your confessions if you don't have any. I probably should update the email, but for now, it's still confessionswithease@gmail.com. When I was in my freshman year of college, a lizard was entertaining me while also entertaining another girl.
A lizard. I love that.
I was deliriously in love with him, and it didn't help. He was my best friend's roommate, so I was always hearing about the frequency of the other girl he was bringing in. Oh, my God. Yeah, I have been wild. In a similar situation in my freshman year, and I went insane, literally. The straw broke the camel's back when the other girl stole a dab pen from my friend, and we both decided to get vengeance. We made a trip to the store for supplies. The following are what we did. Unscrewed his air vent and put pieces of tuna inside, poured the tuna juice into his oil diffuser, put Nair into his face wash and hand soap into his face wash. Honestly, not much came from it aside from his hair thinning and him questioning why his room smelled fishy, but don't fuck with me. That's love so that. Fun. I've always read about people doing these crazy Nair. Things with tuna.
Yeah.
Well, and Nair. Oh my gosh, what a blast. That is
I love that you actually put action to it.
I wish I would have sought revenge on, well, actually I took things too far. He told me he wanted his life back, so I guess I didn't get my revenge on him. He didn't even deserve revenge, but yeah. Okay, I am so tired, so I'm gonna go to bed, but I love you, bestie, and happy we will Friday. See you in next week's episode.
Love you.